And hello. Oh, well, this is the way it starts out every week, isn't it? So I surprise myself when I come on. Oh my God, he's on. Oh, wait a minute. That's me. Hi, everybody. I'm RJ Ogren, the artist, former audio-animatronic artist at Walt Disney World in the 70s with three other artists. And I'm going to paint headless. So if you'll hold on a minute, we'll just... And there we have people joining already. Hey, Jeff and Gail and Jonathan. And oh, hold on. Did this before. Jern, and I hope I'm saying that, G-E-R-N. Anyway, hi, Gail and Mike and Lisa and Stuart. Lisa Freilinger. Hi, Lisa. See that wave? Big blur. I'm going to take my glasses off. My eyes are still adjusting. I only have to put two drops a day in my left eye. My right eye is supposedly done. I go back to the doctors at the VA a week from Thursday. And we'll find out exactly. If I have to wear glasses at all. I was hoping just to have to wear the readers, which worked fine, except I do have a little bit of astigmatism in the right eye, which affects some of my what I'm doing. So when I... Hi, Lisa. And Robert, there you are. Lotta and I ate in Disneyland. Are in Disneyland right now. Oh, that's fantastic. I hate you. Well, I'm here with this. So we're actually going to paint. I'm going to white out the sword. I'm going to do something here with the pumpkin and in flames. And I'm going to paint this tree to show you how that happens. And I'm going to turn the thing a little bit so you can see the tree behind the pumpkin, which is done, the trees. The one in the foreground, and I'm going to do that same thing with the one right behind me here. But anyway, I got all kinds of exciting things going on. I put a thing on Disney Fun and Games this past week, last Friday. I didn't do one today, sorry. But anyway, it was about what was at the top of the stairs when you got on the attraction at Disney World, the Haunted Mansion, and you rode up the staircase, what was the first thing you saw at the top of the stairs? And that was a lot of fun with that one, actually, because now there are stairs that you see that move around. What was there before was the question, and they were giant spiders. Yes, the four of us took care of those giant spiders, and we actually... when we did a total rehab on the Haunted Mansion after the incident with the bullet holes in the glass in the Grand Ballroom and that glass was being replaced, we had 3 weeks to totally redo the mansion, which we did. We did all the figures and everything. And we also took the spiders and repainted them. And they were big. They were, about a foot and a half across. I think a couple of them are a little bigger than that. And they were painted in black light. So we painted them, and then we restrung all new webs for them. And this was in a heavy line that was cotton-based line that would glow in the black light. And then each of these webs had a little, I don't remember if all of them had one. I think most of them did, but they had a little motor that would run, and it would, every few seconds or so, it would tweak the web and cause it to vibrate as if the spider were moving. It was fun to do. So anyway, hi, Larry. Oh, yeah, Rebecca. Yes, it was cool. It was fun to do. I like doing spiders, and which is really funny because I do them and have done them for years in haunted houses. And thank you, Stacy, on the painting. Robert. Well, you're at Disney. Darn. So yeah, I have a fear of spiders. The one time when I was about 8 years old, and I went, only time ever that I went to camp that my mother allowed me to go, I was sleeping on the top bunk of a bunk bed in the one cabin, and a spider came down from straight down from the ceiling, and it bit me right here, and my whole face swelled up. Apparently, I'm not good with spiders. So, and I wrote about that in our Remembering the Magic, about turning around and get a face full of spider web when I was working on the gorilla in the Jungle Cruise, and didn't realize there was a real web there with a fairly large real spider. I think you could hear me scream all the way through the jungle and probably on Main Street. And I also have a fear of giant ants. I'm talking about really big ants, the size of a room. No, that's in the book I wrote about the design of fear. It's about the haunted mansion and all the haunted houses I've done. And it's about also being scared at the age of 10 by a movie called Them, which were giant ants. And of course, every time we find an ant in the house, we have had the exterminators out, and they've controlled the ant population that was attacking our house. So that's fixed. Now, couple of other quick things. Lisa, no spider for me. Yeah, I agree with you. Jenny, love seeing you work and hearing your stories. Well, thank you. I keep waiting for somebody to say, shut up. Okay. Larry, 131 days to Halloween. That's right. Woo! And here I am painting a flaming pumpkin. Anyway, so glad you're all here today. And yes, if you've just joined, I will be painting. I'm going to show you how to paint this gnarly tree here. This is only the first coat that's on it. The tree over here is done, or trees. I'm painting some in the background, which are darker. And I have to point out right here where it's just blue, there's the road going off in the distance, which goes to the covered bridge. I had the covered bridge painted right there, but it wasn't working. It was going to interfere because the horse and the rider both have white reflections on them, and it was white on the front of that covered bridge. Just too much, so I'm just going to make it more of the trees in the distance here, and so the road goes around, and then just have to imagine that the covered bridge is behind the horse. You can do that. So subtitle on our book, Imagination and Dreams Are Forever, our third book, is still ongoing. We're going to do that until about the second week of August. So if you want to submit, just message me with your idea. You can go to Suzanne's blog at srogren.blogspot.com, and she actually has a piece she wrote about what we're doing with that. We have the main title of the book, but we want to have a subtitle which explains, and it can't be real long, so it explains what the book is about. Like in our first book, which we had on there, and it says the unique careers together in a dream, the unique careers of a husband and wife in the early decades of Walt Disney World. So people knew what they were picking up. We did not do that on the second book in the series, of which will be three with the third book. Neat thing is, and we haven't decided, we're working on getting someone to do the foreword for the third book. The first one, our foreword in the book, is by Alice Davis. A good friend. She's also a Disney legend, just so happens. And she designed all the costumes for many of the attractions at Disneyland and Disney World. And her husband just happened to be Mark Davis, who was one of my bosses. And Bev Bergeron, who did the co-wrote the Diamond Horseshoe Review, which was ran for 16 years at Disney World. And he was the comedian magician in the show. Wally Bogue, who he wrote it with, did the Diamond Horseshoe in California at Disneyland. And Bev has been a great friend for many years, and he and I collaborated on a book that Bev wrote about magic, and I did all the illustrations. And while I've got the books out, wait a minute. Oh, it's Israel. Hi, Israel. Thanks, brother. Hi. Well, nice. Same back to you, Israel. Yes. Glad to have you on here, Israel Ray. He and I have been going back and forth on some conversations. But anyway, and my book, The Design of Fear, like I said, it does have a long chapter in there also about the Haunted Mansion and all the blacklight work I did and all the designs I've done in haunted houses for many years, like on the Queen Mary, in Long Beach, etc. And it's also about what scares me in real and imagined. And then my favorite is Suzanne's novel, Ribbons, which you really would love this book. It's not a book written for women. It's a good novel. It takes place in Lexington, Virginia, where VMI and Washington Lee are. And then it ends, I shouldn't say ends, it goes into England, which we've visited numerous times. So the announcement I want to make, now that I've got these books out here, buy these books, is that, of course, like I said, we have the contest going on. And a quick reminder on the contest, before I make the announcement on the books, reminder on the subtitle contest. If we pick what you come up with, we've got about 27 so far that have submitted. And some of those are people that submitted 2 and 3 ideas. You can do more than one. But so message me with your thoughts. I then put them in a journal with your name so that when we get them all together, we can sit down and decide what we want to do there. You will get your name in the book and the acknowledgments or the front part of the book or in the acknowledgments. And you also get a signed personal copy of the book from us. So, and I am drinking from a mug. I am drinking coffee. I actually have a Fantasia mug that I got last year from our daughter and Alan. And I got this because there's a lot of color, because it's been raining for 2 days and it just finally stopped. It's like 68 degrees, which I love. But I had the window open, but it's also very windy. So I had a cool breeze flying in here. Creme brulee flavoring in this one. But anyway, on our books, and this will include the new book when it comes out, we will give you more information the end of next week. We've just been given approval by our publisher, Theme Park Press, because a lot of you have asked for autographed copies of our books. And you can order them from Amazon, but we can't autograph them. You order the books, or through Theme Park Press, which also goes through Amazon. We can buy, Suzanne and I can buy copies of our book and at half price, and then we would sell them at book signings, but that's all we could do before. Basically, it was what we were supposed to do. Well, now it has changed, and we can buy copies of the books, have them sent to us, and then if you want a book signed by us, you want it dedicated to somebody, we can do that. And I'm more than happy to, and we can send a book rate. So what we're going to be announcing is what that will cost. I think the book rate and envelopes and stuff, we're just talking dollars, like between $5 and $10 to ship. I think if it's just one book, it's only like $4 or $5, but it will definitely be under that. And just so you know, Together in a Dream is $18, and the other three books are all $15 each. When you buy one of our books, or all, I mean, whatever. So that's cool. We're excited about that. and we're setting it up so we'll be able to do that, because it does take time. I mean, we have to, you know, run and buy stuff, and then we have to package it up, and then we have to run to the post office and everything else, but we're more than happy to do it if you would like. And Lisa Fantasia scares you. I don't know why. Now that's funny. That's good. I love you, Lisa. Okay. I thought I was weird with the giant ants, but Fantasia? Okay. I'm thinking of the movie, trying to think what scares you in Fantasia? Come on. So, okay, so some of you are going like, cool, yeah, whatever. All right. And getting most of the announcements out of the way. You saw the pictures I posted, one in the Haunted Mansion, which I'll talk about in a little bit, and the other about our first time at Disney, actually in the soft opening of Walt Disney World in September of 1971, and I posted some pictures. Now that we have that out of the way, so why don't I, the dancing brooms, Lisa, we're, want to know where we're going to put in our backyard of our house? I'm going to be building next summer. I hope to have it done. I'm building a waterfall as part of that. And we're also putting a shed back there for our garden tools. But I'm putting a whole front on the shed that's going to be the Seven Dwarfs cottage, which will be a lot of fun. But then I'm also building this waterfall feature that it's, and I'm going to make two of the brooms. You ready for this, Lisa? On the waterfall, and they'll have two buckets each. One bucket will have flowers in it. The other bucket will be worked into the waterfall, so as the water comes down, they'll fill the buckets and cascade down into other things down the waterfall. Boy, what a project. But that's going to be fun. Yes, and Bald Mountain and, oh yes, Bald Mountain is scary. And it's a, how do you say that? Camabog are a little scary. Well, anyway, you're right. Lisa, no! So when you come visit us in Chicago, Lisa, we can take you out to the waterfall with the brooms, which will be like 6 feet tall. Wait, hold on, don't go anywhere. hold that thought. I'm here, don't go away. One of my favorite stuffed items. No, I'm just, did I scare you? Oh, okay, I'm gonna actually paint. I don't knock something over here and talk about some other stuff. And also in a little bit, I'll announce who's going to be with me next week, which will be a lot of fun. If you've just joined, if you haven't been on here before, I'm RJ Ogren, the artist. I worked at Walt Disney World as an audio animatronic artist in the 70s. And you can go to our website that Suzanne and I share, but it's still just rjogren.com. We left it at that, but we share it and read all about us. Now, a tree. I have ivory black, one cup here. I have white, titanium white, and then I have two shades of blue that I've mixed, and I use cobalt blue and titanium white, so the darker shade of this is very little white in it, but I mixed black into that ivory black. I also mixed ivory black into the lighter color, but it has a lot more white in it. So I have the two main shades I need. And what I will do here is start right on, let's make sure you can see where I'm at. Yeah, okay. And I've got a nice round brush here that is a number 12 round brush. I hardly ever look at the numbers on brushes anymore. Okay. So we want to keep it gnarly. And as I'm putting this second coat on, I am adding a little bit to the edges so that it gets a little gnarlier. Okay, I'm going to get this one branch in. Now I'm working in acrylic, so this is already drying quite quickly. And I want to take some ivory black and do some shading in there and a little bit and I'm leaving some of that. I'm leaving this streaky look to it, which adds to the look. I don't want it to be real black. I want it to be more of a dark bluish gray. Okay. And I'm just using the same brush. I'm not switching brushes. Here's the fun one. This one's going to come out into the over the background here. And we'll have it go behind his sword. Yes, I know I'm painting over the sword at the moment. Don't give me a hard time. So, yeah, we'll take it up there. This gives it more depth, having parts of trees in front of others. We'll add another one there, and then we'll take some more the ivory black, and add that in. Now, what I posted on my The Haunted Mansion and Beyond with RJ Ogren on that group, and please tell your friends to come join. The more the merrier. But what I had posted on there was the picture of the book in the, it's in the bookcase. When you ride by in the Haunted Mansion, wait a minute, I better put this on first. I need to put a little bit of light, the lighter blue. I'm going to put it on this edge. My light sources are varied. Light's basically coming from behind, so I pick up light at different areas on the trees. It's in the cartoon that way. So there we go. And when this is all dry, I'll come back in and put some white highlights into this. Okay, so anyway, the book that I posted was a good sized solid book, but it's actually a metal frame because it's got a motor. And you can see in the picture the mechanism on it that hooks into the motor and stuff. And when the ladder on the bookshelf moves back and forth, give the impression there's a ghost you can't see looking for books. It comes by this one book, and the book would shift out of the bookcase just a little bit and then tip, you know, toward you on the ride, and goes back in up again and back in. What they had done originally was they took actually the cover off of a very old book and glued it right onto that metal frame. And it worked great, but over 5-6 years, it was starting to wear away. So we had them take it out. We had the audiomatronic maintenance people take that book out, and we brought it down to our studio behind Small World, and I got the job of totally redoing it. Took the old book cover off, scraped everything off, smoothed it out. I took the ribs off of the binder on the book because I could use those and glue them back on. They weren't damaged. And then instead of putting another book on it, another book cover, I actually took artist's canvas, this kind of canvas that was already primed, and glued it right onto that frame and around the binding on the end, and then glued the ribs back on. And then I proceeded, using the original book, I had it laid out beside me, I repainted the book. I repainted the aging on it and the cracks and everything, so it looked exactly the way the book looked before. I write about this in our first book, Together in a Dream, and the funny part about it is when I got it all done, I was so proud of it, so I took a picture of it. They put it back into the attraction, and then when we rode through we walked through the next day to look at it, when you're in that low light, it just looks like a plain brown book that comes out. You can't see any of the detail or the aging or anything. But that's Disney. So that's always fun. Lisa, you are, I just saw your thing, you are wicked. I knew you'd like that little stuffed broomstick. Yes, it is acrylic paint, Lisa. I'm going real quick now to look at light, and Disney art isn't always consistent in reality. No, it's not, you're right. The lighting normally, if I was just making this up, I would have probably all the light coming from, well, this particular piece, the light's coming from everywhere. Because he's getting light from behind him, which gives you these white highlights that'll be on his body and on the horse. You can sort of see where I've left some. I painted some white here. But then in the trees, there's light coming from different directions, over this way and over this way. So it's a very strange force. So stolen art tips, yeah. Okay, and I'm going to switch down here real quick. Light from a lightning bolt. Yeah, yes. Kevin, thank you. Just dropped in. Very nice. Thank you, Kevin. San Diego Chargers. Okay, I need coffee. All right. And then on my other group site, RJ Ogren and Disney, I had put a thing in there about the, what was it? Oh, that was in September of 1971 when we found out. We were still in Miami. I was still going to University of Miami. In fact, I was still working for architects too. And we found out they were doing a soft opening. So we went up to Orlando and got a hotel room. There was one hotel between Disney property and Orlando, and there were no lights on I-4 on the highway. It was pitch black at night. We were going back to the hotel. We couldn't see it because it was so dark. We almost went past the hotel. It was a Howard Johnson's, which isn't a Howard Johnson's anymore. It was one of the ones over there by Buena Vista. And so That was funny. But it was fantastic. I mean, we when we saw the parade, as you can see in those pictures, there's practically nobody there. There were crowds were so small, which was wonderful. Of course, some things weren't running yet. The monorails weren't running, so they actually took us on trams from the TTC all the way to the front gate of the Magic Kingdom. But when we got inside, we could walk into every attraction. Just there was no line, nothing. You would get on a like Peter Pan, and there'd only be four other people. Just got out in front of you. It was really neat. And we were very lucky. And that's, of course, when Susie took the picture of me dancing down the street with the characters. There were no floats in the parade, just the bands. I do have another picture. There were also knights on horses. Yeah, I should put that on. Gosh, but it was mostly characters and the bands. And of course, the 1776 fife and drum, which was there for years at Disney, and eventually it was taken out, which is kind of sad because that was mainstay of Liberty Square, was that fife and drum and the thing. I can put my glasses down. All right, now, that being said, and yes, I still have an announcement about who's going to be on next week. Half an hour. I feel like Susie says I talk too much. If I get on here, I'm going like, boy, horses, yes, horses, yes. Love. I know you love horses, Lisa. And Lisa, we know each other from the 10 years that we moved from Orlando in 1994 and lived for 10 years in Lexington, Virginia. That's why Suzanne's book, Ribbons, takes place mostly in Lexington, Virginia, at a bed and breakfast. It was centered around that, but there's some intrigue and things that happen in the book. So, and she does talk in the book about Virginia Military Institute and stuff, but yeah, love horses. Our daughter rode horses competitively when she was young, and our daughter Dawn and our daughter-in-law Sandy not only still rides whenever she gets the chance and used to train young riders herself, and she was competitive. Have you heard about the Doug Henning film coming out soon, people? Yes. I know that that is a biopic, I think, that is being worked on, and that would be fantastic if you could get this out about Doug Henning, the magician. He was a great magician, great entertainer. Every time we saw he was going to be on a show, we made sure we saw it. Okay. Now, I'm going to go back to the tree. With the paper brush again. And now that we've done that, first, I will paint this. I paint on the edges of the paintings. So when I'm done with this, I've already painted the first coat and over the edges of the painting. But when I'm done with everything here, I'll go back up and paint the tree, actually wrapping around the side. I would do it now, but then I'd have to stand up. I don't want to stand up. Still there. Okay. Now we'll paint. I'm going to paint hat because this is drying fast, you know, on acrylic, so I'm going to paint just part of the tree here. I'm going to make the edge of it a little uneven on the tree, and yeah, we're still in there. I have to look over at the screen to see if you can see what I'm doing. And actually, this I am going to go around the edge because this tree actually, the trunk of this tree goes right around the edge of the painting. There we go. Okay. All right, got that in. Let's get some of this dark black. A little bit in here. After I get it on there, I blend it out. Some areas can be darker than others. I like to work fast when I do something like this. Gosh, I've done so many trees and haunted houses that are similar to these. And the haunted houses around the country, I paint them in 3D. Blacklight. I paint trees and actually in colors. I could do trees in the background in blue, and then trees the next level with green tones, or and then the trees in the foreground with reddish tones to them and browns, and they would overlap. And with the 3D glasses on, when you walk through a room, like the trees were actually shifting in front of each other as you walk by. Pretty cool effect. Okay, now I'm putting the lighter blue in here. And this is where I'll put some white highlights afterwards. Okay. Take it around the edge a little bit. Okay. And back. There we go. I'm going to show you something else on here too after I get this main part of the tree done. All right. Yeah. I told you last week this is actually is the first painting of the headless horseman. Although I did a headless horseman with Ichabod and actually Mickey, Donald, and Goofy. It was for a yard display for Halloween. It was in black light 3D. So that was a lot of fun. I'm making the edges of this tree a little bit more uneven. And I'll wrap it around. Yes, I'm painting into the horse as we speak. And then I'm getting some more of the black. So you can let the brush just work for you. And when I do it, I actually will twirl the brush. I'll make that a little bit darker up there. There we go. Oops. There we go. Okay. Man, we just had a blast of wind just came through. Sounded like it was going to shake the house. Woo! Now this right here actually is some, yes, not part of the tree actually. I'm going to change this and make this, yeah, some ground cover. Take it around the side where you can't see. And I'm going to stop in a second and look at what's going on. But I want this to be there is the road going by here. So this is actually some ground cover, berm, whatever you want to call it. There we go. And this will all kind of blend together. Some more black. And then come back to that later after that dries. What I want to show you is here. The sword I penciled in. I had it laid out before, but then as I was painting, I painted over parts of it and I just made a mistake. Oh no, RJ made. So where are you at, Lisa? Oh, it's gloomy there too. Oh gosh, yeah. little trees, Bob Ross. Yes, Bob Ross. If you have, don't know, Bob Ross and I were very good friends, Suzanne and Bob Ross and I. And he lived about a half a mile from our house in Orlando, and I even did a couple of videos for Bob Ross, but great guy. His happy trees. I don't know if you'd qualify these as happy trees, though. So anyway, all right, yeah, so just a little bit ago, a little bit of water. It's a little bit dry. I penciled in the sword again so I could lay it out just with the first coat here. The sword will actually have, I'll fix that later. I'm at such a weird angle right now when I'm painting it. And I'm stretching out. Normally I would be like this. So should have the cameraman pull in closer. What cameraman? Wait a minute. Oop, a little bit more there. And the handle of the sword is actually white also. So I'm just going to do that right now. There'll be some definition of his fingers and stuff in there. Now on the, yes, Lexington, Virginia. Yay. I see all of you are having your own conversations now. Just ignore that guy on the screen. I'm going to turn this a little, whoops, the other way. So you can see the pumpkin that I actually had just put into, just put some orange in it to define it, but I'm laying out some flames and I'm gonna make this, actually these flames, a lot more exciting looking than what they are in the actual movie. I mean, there's flames on it in the movie, but I wanna really get see more larger flames coming up. And why am I painting it white, right? Because if I just go to painting yellow and orange flames, I don't know if you can tell, I mean, you can see some of the lines, you can see some of my pencil work in there. Orange, red, yellow, they don't cover over darker colors or lines. You have to keep painting it. You have to get so much paint on there after a while, it's ridiculous. What you want to do first is paint that what is going to be those colors in titanium white. And then when you go to paint your colors on top, it comes out really nice. And you don't get frustrated trying to get it painted. There we go. So, now I'm going to switch to a little bit bigger brush. Don't mind my back. I'm wearing a very old Haunted Mansion shirt. It's kind of, picture's kind of cracking and stuff. And it's really hard to see there you go, with ghosts and stuff. Jeez, bought this a long time ago. So I'm actually going to paint over the orange. So that when I do the final orange coloring, it'll go on real nice. And I can do all my detail. And I'm just going to paint right over his eyes. I can put those back in easily. And that will work really nice. Yeah. Now you know why it takes time to do a painting. You have to do it in layers, in acrylics, different items that you're painting. I put down a base coat first on everything. Excuse me. That's why I quickly laid this out in black, the whole figure, figures. And what I will be doing next is finishing some highlights on these gnarly trees and putting some more of these branches coming in, the black ones, there'll be some over here, and then in the road, well, you'll see there's some groove lines. That's not finished. I'll be doing that too, so the road will look really worn by wagon tracks and stuff. So that's where we are. And oh look, I've been on for 50 minutes. And there you go, hashtag titanium white. mesmerized by my painting. Oh, it's awesome. Thank you, Lisa. It's nice. Really appreciate that. Now, what I want to tell you about is my mustache. No, I'm not going to shave it off. I thought I had, because people like my mustache or they don't. Why I have one. I am not trying to copy Walt Disney. But back in the late 60s, 70s, I grew a mustache, which came way down here. And I, of course, had really long hair. And over the years, of course, my mustache got shorter once we got about 1970. Well, actually, when I went to work for Disney, I had to shave it off. Couldn't have a mustache. After I left Disney, I grew a mustache back again, off and on over the years. I've had a mustache, and actually, I think about 4 years ago, I shaved off my mustache, and everybody in the family didn't like the way I looked without the mustache. So here it is. That's it. That's why I have a mustache. It's soft. Okay. And tomorrow morning, we're going to the Aurora Pancake House, which has been in business for 70 years, right here in close to downtown Aurora, very close to downtown Aurora. And in fact, it's just a few blocks away from the hospital that I was born in here in Aurora. But we're going there because they have Swedish pancakes, real Swedish pancake, not crepes that they call Swedish crepes or anything else. Swedish pancakes are very thin, and they have a little bit different, really, really nice flavor to them as opposed to regular pancake. It's too hard to explain. But then you get lingonberries go on it, and lingonberry butter, and I like to put syrup on it. A lot of people don't, but looking forward to it because I haven't been to this restaurant since I was a kid. And actually, there's a Dairy Queen not too far away, and a Dairy Queen we were at last night, and it's a Dairy Queen that's been there for 70 plus years. And when we sit down to eat our ice cream last night, Hot Fudge Sundays, we're only a block away from the house where one of my grandmothers and grandfathers live, and we could see it. We're sitting there. I says, "There's the house. I spent so much time in that house." Kind of neat. And Canadian bacon. Canadian white and Canadian bacon. Okay, I'm missing out on a whole bunch of things here. You guys are doing. Let me see what else you've said. Then I'm going to tell you who's going to be on next week. Hi, Sarah. I think I'm getting this in reverse order. So that's why it's getting to be so funny. I'm trying to scroll down. And come on. Okay. Now I'm going the other way. Gee. Okay. Well, anyway, enough of that. The announcement is that next week, I probably painting a little bit maybe, but I'll certainly have a painting here. This one will be done by Monday. Pilata, Monday. Have fun at Disneyland, by the way. I know you are. And James. But anyway, I should be working on a blacklight painting of the witch's hand and the apple. So that'll be fun. And also I've got another painting I'm starting on, which is a wedding painting, a couple in front of the castle, obviously in the distance. That'll be a lot of fun. That's a big painting like this one. Now, next week, though, I'm having a very good friend, fellow actor. We've been in plays together. He is so much fun to work with. And it's Jim Martin. Jim Martin, where did I write that? Yeah. Just to give you a little background, he is a cartoonist, a designer. Cartoonist. He enjoys theater and set design. Yes, he's a set designer, scenic designer like me. He's helped me on sets. He's phenomenal. And he works in puppetry. Ah. But one of the neat things is that he has designed Happy Meal toys for the past 21 years, working on just about every license imaginable. So all those Happy Meals with all those toys, Jim probably was the one who designed it. And he is a lot of fun. We're going to have a blast. We are really going to have fun. And he said he would bring some of his puppets. I have I can only imagine what he'll show up with, because he does amazing puppets. Everybody, I want to thank you again for joining in. And like I said, we will be announcing next week how you can if you order our books directly from us, and we will autograph them and dedicate the books however you want. And we can ship all four books together. We can, you can just buy one book, however you want to do it. You're paying, you'll still be paying what you pay on Amazon for the price of the book. We order the books, we have them shipped here, and then we can, you can order them from us and tell us what you want put in the book, and we will send it off to you. So we'll have a better idea on the prices for shipping, which packaging, which I said was going to be somewhere between $4 and $10. I doubt that it'll be $10. I think it's going to be more in the $4 to $7 range. But Suzanne is looking into that to get everything figured out, because we can send them book rate, which is great. It's a lot less than sending something by regular mail. So everybody have a great weekend. That's right. We're going to go have a nice breakfast in the morning. I'm going to have my Swedish pancakes. Yay! On that note, everybody, again, it's been fun. See you next week. Jim Martin will be on, and we're going to have some fun. And I will be showing pictures of this when it is finished. And it'll be sent out on probably Tuesday. And the, oh, by the way, stretch room painting I did get that finished a few days back. But I haven't been able to send it. It has to go to Texas. And it's been raining here for a couple of days, so we decided we'd wait. So supposedly, tomorrow morning, I will be over at UPS and sending that up. Okay, I am going to say goodbye. See you all.